So today's speaker is Charles Delman from EIU. He's going to talk about the L-space surgery conjecture.
Right. Well, thank you very much for inviting me, for coming. Those who are really attentive would notice that there's a slight change in the title. And this is because when I sent the abstract, Rachel and I were still debating how to phrase our conjecture. And we decided that we should make two of them. And the name I gave you previously worked well for the weaker of the two, but I actually want to talk about the stronger of the two. So that'll all become apparent as the talk goes on. So I'll start with a little bit of background. So foliation is just a decomposition of a manifold into leaves of lower dimension. And we are going to think of codimension one and leaf dimension two in a three-dimensional manifold. We're going to assume leaves are smooth, but the transverse direction doesn't need to be. Okay, it'll just be topological. A codimension one foliation of a three manifold is taut if there's a circle transversely intersecting every leaf. And as a remark, so taut foliations have been studied for a long time, going back to Gabai and Thurston. And a closed manifold that admits a taut foliation is covered by R3. So if it's irreducible, the fundamental group is infinite. So there are definitely some nice properties of manifolds admitting taut foliations, similar to those that admit incompressible surfaces, for example. Okay, so to save words, I'm just going to make the following definition, which I'm afraid I forgot to italicize, but foliar is the word. A three-manifold is foliar if it admits a taut co-orientable codimension one foliation. All right, the other ingredient in this talk, which is going to remain something of a black box, is Heegard-Floer homology, introduced by Peter Ozsváth and Zoltán Szabó. And so all we need to know about it is that it's an F2 vector space, and its rank is at least as great as the magnitude of the first homology group. So this applies, I should have said, to rational homology spheres. So that means that first integer homology is torsion. So there's some number of elements in that group, and the rank is always at least as big as that. And if equality holds, the manifold's called a Lens space. An L space, and I think the name L comes from the fact that Lens spaces are the classical examples. Okay. In fact, all spherical manifolds are L spaces. There's a theorem that says that any manifold that admits a taut co-orientable foliation, or I guess I should use the word I introduced, any foliar manifold, is not an N space, not an L space. So this goes back originally to Eliashberg and Thurston, who showed in their confoliations manuscript, or monograph, I should say, that if you have a taut co-orientable foliation, it can be deformed to get a positive-negative contact structure. That does require originally a smooth foliation. I think C2 is sufficient, but some level of smoothness. Then Ozsváth and Szabó showed that that implied that Heegard-Floer homology couldn't be minimal. So when I say minimal or trivial, I just mean that minimal rank, equality in that inequality up there. Then Kazez-Roberts recently showed that you could weaken the smoothness condition, so you just need a continuously varying tangent plane in your foliation is sufficient. So Ozsváth and Szabó asked the question of whether the converse would hold for irreducible three manifolds. So you do need this additional irreducibility because manifold, as I said, manifold admitting a taut foliation has got to be irreducible, but an L space need not be irreducible. So we do need this irreducibility condition. And this has been actually conjectured as part of the Boyer-Gordon-Watson conjecture, which also suggests that a taut foliation is equivalent to a orderability of the fundamental group. And I am told that Juhasz has conjectured this foliation part of it, but I'm not sure, which is why I put the question mark there. Okay, most of you, I'm sure, know what a knot is. So we're going to be talking about classical knots in the three-dimensional sphere. There's an alternating one. Alternating just means that it alternates between overcrossings and undercrossings as you go around the knot. And note that a regular neighborhood, that is if you fatten it up by taking a product with a suitably small D2, you know, two disc, you will get a solid torus, which leads to the idea of creating manifolds by an operation known as Dehn surgery. So if you remove a solid torus from the sphere and then glue in a solid torus by whatever homeomorphism of its boundary that you like, you get a three manifold. And the result depends only on the curve to which the meridian of the solid torus is glued. So you just write that curve in terms of longitudes and meridian coefficients. How many longitudes, how many meridians, generally written as a fraction, meridian over longitude, which can be 1 over 0 if it's just a meridian, but that's trivial surgery, gives us 3 back. So if I don't mention in the future, anytime I say Dehn surgery, I'm ignoring the trivial surgery. Going to consider 2 very interesting types of knots. The first, which I already illustrated, was alternating knots. And they form sort of a skeleton for knots, right, in that, of course, a very large class of knots, and they're kind of like the natural diagrams you would draw in other knots that you obtain from them by switching, you know, some number of crossings. And then another interesting class of knots is the Montesinos knots, which is pretty much the simplest class of knots you can build out of rational tangles. So a tangle is just a ball with 2 strands running through it, and a rational tangle is a tangle such as this. So what you should think of is you should think of these squares as pillowcases. So they're actually 2 spheres, but think of them with the front and the back like a pillowcase. No seam to put your pillow in, but a pillowcase. And a rational tangle is a tangle that's given by just some rational slope on the inner sphere, right? So you go into your tangle and then you wrap around a certain number of times according to some slope, right, which you can read off from that square. You can actually see it as coming from a branch covering by a torus, coming from a branch covering by the plane. But anyhow, there's this natural notion of slope, okay? Montesinos knot is just a knot that's obtained by stringing a bunch of those together in a necklace. We will separate any like integer full twists from the rational tangle. So we will think of that as the Montesinos knot with instructions 1/3, 2/5, right? So this is 1/3. This, if you want to think about it, is 2/5, right? Goes up 2 out of 5, 3/5 here, and -1 for the -1 twist. And the pretzel knots are just those Montesinos knots that arise simply from tangles of type 1 over n, that they're like pretzels, you know, just a string of twisted bands. Okay, so a little more terminology just to save some long sentences. So a knot K is persistently foliar if every manifold obtained by non-trivial Dehn surgery on that knot is foliar. Okay, so we're going to be interested in knots so that any surgery you do will give you a manifold admitting a taut co-orientable foliation. And that may seem surprising that there are actually lots of those. In fact, all two bridge knots and all Montesinos knots that are not pretzel knots and all alternating knots that are not torus knots, as I will show. And a knot is an L-space knot if some non-trivial surgery on K yields an L-space. And it's an immediate corollary of that theorem I mentioned before, that clearly if a knot is persistently foliar, it is not an L-space knot, right? Because a foliar manifold can't be an L-space. All right, so I'd like to introduce a couple of conjectures that Rachel Roberts and I would like to put forward. L-space knot conjecture simply says that if K does not admit a non-trivial reducible or L-space surgery, then K is persistently foliar. But more generally, what about knots that might have L-space surgeries? What about the other ones? So the L-space surgery conjecture, or I actually call it fully the classical L-space surgery conjecture to remind you that we are talking about knots in S3, classical knots. A manifold obtained by Dehn surgery on K is foliar if and only if it is irreducible and not in L-space. So in other words, whatever surgery you do, you either get a reducible manifold in L-space, or if you don't get one of those, you get a foliar manifold. Okay, so that's the conjecture, or I should say it's really posed more as an open question. I don't have any deep reason to believe it's true, but as you'll see, the evidence so far is in its favor, for whatever that's worth. So all alternating knots satisfy the L-space surgery conjecture, and in particular, every non-torus alternating knot is persistently foliar. And for torus knots, I'm going to kind of leave torus knots aside. Their surgeries are well understood. And the result for torus knots follows from the work of a whole bunch of people. I hope I didn't leave anyone out. Boyer, Eisenbud, Hirsch, Neumann, Jenkins, Neumann, Raimi. And that's how you can classify which surgeries are foliar. That depends on the, you get either lens spaces or connected sums of lens spaces, or in general, ciphered fibered manifolds with up to three singular fibers. And it's the ciphered coefficient. Coefficients, is that what you call them? Anyway, it's the ciphered invariance is what I meant to say. That ciphered invariance that will tell you whether the manifold is foliar or not, and whether or not it's an L space depends on the genus, and you can put all that information together, and it follows for the torus knots. Actually, the only torus knots that are relevant here in either the alternating or Montesinos knots are the 2N torus knots. Okay, and then for Montesinos knots, L-space surgeries on Montesinos knots have been classified by Baker, Libman, Hedden, and Moore. And Rachel Roberts has some results for the L-space knots as to which range of surgeries gives you L. Well, we know which range gives you L-spaces, and Rachel can prove the other ones. The rest of the range gives you foliar manifolds. Okay, so I'm going to focus actually on the persistently foliar ones. Okay, so I want to tell you something about the methods we use to do it, or at least show you a bunch of pictures that I hope will give you some feel for it, because I think that the methods could be widely applicable beyond these results, and I think they're quite interesting. So, okay, so we're going to start with a spine. So that idea goes all the way back, I think, to Kassler in 65, as far as we know. So a spine is just constructed from a finite succession of transversely intersecting surfaces to create a C1 embedded object that, or actually I guess we'd like the non-singular areas to be smooth, or at least C1. I said C1, never mind, sorry. So that looks locally like one of those neighborhoods. And then we're going to successively introduce smoothing instructions at singular points to obtain a branch surface, which is simply a union of compact surfaces that looks locally like one of those. Okay, so you get a continuous tangent plane. Okay, continuous tangent plane field on your branch surface. And then we will eventually obtain what is often called a laminar branch surface. So we'll obtain a transversely orientable laminar branch surface, for which the complement of an I-bundle neighborhood is a taut sutured manifold. So that's a big bundle of words, so I'll unpack that a little bit for you. So that's an I-bundle neighborhood of a branch surface. Simply means a regular neighborhood, but it is being decomposed as a bundle of intervals that reflects the branching structure. And an I-bundle neighborhood has two types of boundary. Right, it has this boundary that's transverse to fibers, that's called the horizontal boundary, and it has this boundary that lies in fibers, that's called the vertical boundary. And unfortunately, due to time, I can't really lay out sutured manifold theory, but for those of you who know it, right, a sutured manifold, or for those of you who have heard something about it, a sutured manifold is a three manifold with boundary which contains for which we have a designated union of tori and annuli, and the cores of those annuli are called the sutures. And the idea is that you use these sutures to build a foliation. So the sutures divide the boundary into pieces, and what you want to be able to do is add leaves that smoothly limit on those boundaries by going across these sutures. Okay, and pictures will help make this a little clearer. One requirement to get a taut suture manifold, which is going to lead you to a foliation, is that those cores of those sutures are homologically trivial, and you know, so you'll have minimal pieces of boundary that are horizontal that are co-oriented. And that won't always be true on these constructions. It'll eventually be true, but it won't be true at the beginning. So the idea is we will do a kind of more general form of decomposition that will allow us to turn non-orientable leaves into orientable leaves. All right, just a little notation to help read the pictures. So at a double point, it is often going to be the case that one of the three branches is distinguished. So that's the gray one. That'll occur because we'll have surfaces and we'll want to add disc surfaces. So the disc could be a distinguished, for example, a distinguished branch. And so the way we're going to notate how the smoothing instructions go is, well, if the designated or distinguished branch is tangential to the other two branches, then we'll use an arrow to indicate the sync direction in which the bifurcation closes. And otherwise, if the sync direction goes into the distinguished branch, we'll use a diamond. Okay? So that's notation. So diamond means you're coming in, and arrow just points in the direction that you're syncing. All right, so if you think about it, at a triple point, there are 12 possible smoothings, because you have tetrahedral symmetry, you've got six possible sectors meeting at that, you know, whose corners meet at that triple point. Just pick any one of them you want to be your distinguished sector of a double point, and then to get the triple point, you're putting another branch in, and you've got two ways to smooth it, because it has to switch smoothing direction as you go across that little ditch. So that gives you a lot of flexibility. So I'm going to sort of show as best I can in the time allotted how you would put these, how you put this together. Okay, so I guess, does this have time on it? No, so I should probably have my cell phone out to keep track of time, but I turned it off. So if you could warn me about halfway through, that'd be great. Because I can't see the time on the computer.
You're just 18 minutes away.
Okay, 8, okay.
So 30 left.
Yeah, 30 left. Okay, great, and 18 minutes gone, perfect. Okay, so we're gonna work in the exterior of the knot, okay? We're gonna introduce a tube around the knot, in other words, the boundary of a tubular or regular neighborhood of the knot. And this tube is gonna be part of the spine, okay? And by convention, just because it's easier to think of this way, this is the opposite of the usual convention when you do Dehn surgery. Outward normal is going to point out of the tube, so out instead of in to the regular neighborhood. Okay. The goal is to build the spine having meridional intersections with that tube and to smooth them in such a way that you get outward pointing sync directions on an even number of those meridians. Because the reason for that is that after Dehn surgery, that's non-trivial, those meridians will become longitudes. And if you have an even number of longitudes, you've got a taut sutured manifold component. Okay. So for example, I tried to picture it here, right? So if you had two meridians after Dehn surgery, there'll be two longitudes. And two longitudes, you can see, is just a product. You can just fill it in with annuli. But more generally,
So you want all of the branch surface things to go sort of point out, is that right?
Oh, well, it's okay if some are tangential on the outside. You just need an even number of meridional cusps that point out.
Right.
Okay. And any even number will do, right? So if you have four, Alan Hatcher used to call these stack chairs, or monkey saddles, right? You have four or six, you just stack monkey saddles around that torus, right? And they limit one way and then the other, and then the parts of the monkey saddle that separate those go into the sutures. Okay. So as long as the other components are taut sutured manifolds, then you're going to have a persistently foliar knot. You'll get a foliation in any manifold produced by non-trivial surgery. So that's what we mean by persistence. And just want to give a nod to an early idea that I think is sort of the genesis of this, which is the idea of a swallow, follow, closed surface that was used by Menasco and Oertel to get this idea of meridional cusps. Okay, so two methods that we use to do this. One is to just decompose K into tangles along spheres and also into some subtangles, or you can get layers in the tangles. And to, as I said, decompose further along spanning surfaces for the tangles. And then you get something that looks kind of like a Murashigi sum, right? So if you think of what a Murashigi sum is, you have two surfaces and you stick them together along some disk, right? Like that, right? So you have some bits of surface going up and some bits of surface going down, and they meet at the disk, right? And the difference is that, well, first of all, you could take this Murashigi sum and, right, you've got a disk on the inside, but if you've got a separating sphere, you've also got a disk on the outside. You can put them both in and get a branched Murashigi sum. But a more general thing you can do is you can stick two surfaces together without them matching up that way, right? So the branch curves don't have to be like, the alternating sides of a polygon, right? They can be, and I'll show you an example, or at least a picture of an example. And so with suitable choices, you obtain persistence and every component will be a taut sutured manifold. So let me construct like an example. Okay, so here is the tangle of slope 1/3. And if you look at the Ferry diagram, a Ferry complex, it's long known, going back to Hatcher and Thurston, that incompressible surfaces in rational tangles correspond to paths in the Ferry diagram from 1/0 to whatever fraction represents your tangle. So if you want to think about unwinding that, I'll leave that if anyone's bored to see if you can do that in your head, you will get slope 1/3 at the bottom. Okay? And what we've done is simply, right, so you have these saddles, just plumbing here, so you have these saddles, but we're plumbing both in and out where these pieces of surface meet, right? And these are the separating spheres here, right, where you plumbed. And this is just a simple incompressible surface. But the point to note is that if you just take this sphere outside the tangle, right, and just think of the tangle being inside the sphere, what are you going to see? You're just going to see that one twist, okay? So from outside the tangle, what this branch surface looks like is just a little twisted band, okay? And the tangle is, I tried to represent by sort of making it look like a bubble, right? Tangle's inside there, okay, with everything else is inside. Also, note what the complementary regions are between the spheres. They're just tori, because you've got two sphere layers, one inside the other, right, and two holes drilled between them, right? So you've got tori, and you've got two meridians, and, two longitudes and some number of meridians, and, let me get that right. I told you I didn't have my cup of tea, so better slow down. Let's see. So going through the hole, right. So there are longitudes on the surface, but there are two meridians on the, yeah. So there are two meridians from the point of view of the complement, and the number of longitudes depends on the number of twists. Okay? And so you want an even number of twists. And so you have to find an edge path with an even number of twists, and there always is one, okay? So this incompressible surface would indeed give you a taut sutured manifold, okay? But it doesn't have any meridional cusps. The surface just is tangential to the tube everywhere. So let's see how you put one in with a meridional cusp. You do something
like the siphon surface then?
Yeah, that's just a siphon surface. Yeah. That, in fact, is the bitumal oriental siphon surface, right? So now, how do you get these meridional cusps in? How do you do this, you know, different kind of plumbing? I guess level surface diagrams are a little out of fashion, but I kind of like them. So I'll just give you a level surface diagram, and that'll give you a 3D picture. So you start, of course, with these bands of slope infinity at the top, and you've got your tube around the knot, and I want them to be tangential in this pattern, which I call a configuration. So you've got three basic types of configurations up to symmetry. There's this one, and there's the one that looks like two old-fashioned telephone receivers facing each other, and two that looks like two old-fashioned telephone receivers facing apart. So anyway, for slope one-third, we happen to want this one. And you do a bunch of splitting, and you saddle into these. So notice I've saddled in, and that's opened up the possibility of meridian. And then I'm going to put another saddle in that goes around and completes that meridional circle. So this is going to enable me to get a meridional outward pointing cusp here and there. Okay, so I get two of them. The path that corresponds to, if you just keep track of the slopes, well, really, you'd have to extend the fairy diagram to include some more edges and simplices. It looks something like that, but we can just project it into the standard fairy diagram. And this goes back, actually, to my thesis, although this is a refinement of it. And I called it a channel just because it kind of burrows through the diagram and doesn't, you know, it takes shortcuts through the edges, okay? Here's what it looks like in 3D, right? So basically, you've got your bands of slope, say infinity, and you got your separating sphere. You've got some branch curves here, and it looks like slope infinity above, and as you may have noticed from the picture, I'll go back, slope 1/2 down below, and you've got a triple point over here, where the groove passes through the vertical surface. So it's a different kind of smoothing than your cipher surface would have. And the meridian would look something like that. You've got where the saddle took it out and where the saddle puts it back in, you get a meridional circle around the knot. So like I was saying, see slope, these would be slope 1/2, right? Okay, so that's your sort of standard channel that gives you two meridians. And if you stick it into a Montesinos knot, you can make it persistent foliar. So persistently foliar. So here, for example, is how to show that the 333 pretzel knot is persistently foliar. This is one that Cameron asked about a little while back. So I'll just put ciphered surface in there, but I'll put this channel construction in here. And notice that after the channel's done, I turn across two triangles, so I'm still getting an even number of longitudes on that other component. And then what about from the outside? Well, twisted band, slope zero as you approach the channel, right? So from the top, you're seeing slope zero, untwisted band, two twists. So from the outside, right, the complement looks like the complement of a double twisted annulus, so also suit taut. Okay. So this idea of looking at the complements of surfaces is very important. So if you've looked at Gabai's earlier work, you know that like he'll start with a ciphered surface for a knot, say an alternating knot, for example, and then you decompose with a disc. So you put a disc leaf in, and what you get is something that looks like the complement of a simpler surface. So the way you keep track is that you keep simplifying the surface. That's exactly what we're doing here. The complement is always going to look like the complement of some surface, right? It won't actually, the branch surface itself won't actually be a surface, but if you follow the branch curves and think of those as the edge of a surface, it looks like the complement. The sutures look like they're the edge of some actual surface. All right, so this works great for Montesinos knots because we can use the rational structure, and it shows that all of them are persistently foliar except for some small pretzel knots. Okay, so how do we handle those? So both the small pretzel knots and the alternating knots are handled in a similar way. And so the idea is to generalize this idea of surface sutured manifold decomposition. Okay, So at the top, there's classic sutured manifold decomposition. You've got a surface, you've got a knot, and there's no tube, the knot is just solid, so that black stuff is the boundary of your knot complement. And your surface just meets the boundary transversely, and as you add leaves, you smooth them, and then you go around the knot and you smooth them again, right? So you get something that's transverse to the boundary, okay? And so you're pretty much limited to two ways of doing that, shown here. And what your branch curves do, right, so your one of your sutures is actually the annulus that runs along the knot itself or along the boundary of the knot complement. And then, you know, so this one is going to go that way, and then this one's going to go that way. And if you do it the other way, you'll get a different picture. So now the red one coming in goes out that way, and, you know, the top one goes up instead of down, and the bottom one goes down instead of up. But if you think of it as a spine where everything intersects transversely and then ask, okay, let's use any possible smoothing at those triple points, you get something that's sort of like a generalized surface, or we're only going to use discs, so I'll just call them disc decompositions, but you could use more general surfaces. So this gives you some tremendous advantages. So aside from persistence, the initial spanning surface you use doesn't need to be orientable. Right, so it turns out, like for the small pretzel knots, you want to use the checkerboard surface, which isn't orientable. You can decompose where the boundary of your surface could cross the knot an odd number of times. And this method works for the non-torus alternating knots and also the remaining pretzel knots that are not L-space knots. Okay, so let me just show you some pictures, and how am I doing for time to run through pictures?
Oh, you have 18 minutes left.
18 minutes left, okay, great. All right, so what I've depicted here and in the next several slides are all the local models of how you can smooth the triple points where your decomposing disc runs over the tube, okay? So you can think of, the easy way to think of it is you've got your ciphered surface, or more general surface, doesn't have to be orientable. You got your surface running down around the back and down, and your decomposing disc is going along the surface, hits the tube, goes over the tube, keeps going over the surface, right? It's also kind of nice to deform that so that the surface just runs straight down, because you often want to sort of see your disc as being on one side, going around the tube, crossing the tube, and going on to the other side. So how many ways can you smooth that? Okay, so we divide them into three classes. Type A are the ones in which a meridional circle is part of the branch locus, but it's tangential to the tube. The sink direction doesn't point outward, right? So it's like tubes with skirts, okay? And then you can fit the surface in with either smoothing, so you get these various these four possibilities if the skirt is, you know, it's right side up, in the sense that you usually wear a skirt, depending on how you choose the local orientations of your surfaces to determine how you're going to merge the two tangent planes. And if you look at the notation, this might be worth like just taking a quick look at. You can see that there are basically four types. So if I like to think of it, if you're going across a twist, so it's like diamond, if your disc is going that way, so diamond out, diamond, diamond, in, out, and in, diamond. Okay. And those give rise to different effects on your branch curves. Okay. But the effect on the branch curves is actually pretty simple. You just end up getting twists wherever you have inward pointing arrows, just like in a standard disc decomposition. The diamonds just look like quick down up or up down arrows. So let's see, what else should I maybe say about this? Oh yeah, so you also have to decide, you know, how you're going to smooth at the boundary of the tube, right, at those double points along the tube. And the way we keep track of that is right-hand rule. You just put a local orientation on the knot. And so, you know, if your thumb's pointing that way, the leaves are curling in, limiting in a clock, well, it depends how you look at it. But if you look at it from your thumb going down clockwise and the other way counterclockwise. So those are the four basic type A's.
So these things you're building are oriented?
They're locally oriented.
Locally, I see.
They're locally oriented, maybe not globally oriented, but the orientations give you a nice way of seeing how to do the smoothing instruction. And I'll show you an example where you have the whole knot and you can see. You can also rotate these by 180 degrees, and so that's not really different, but from the point of view of the inside or outside of your decomposing disc, you get, you know, slightly different patterns, right? So those are useful. So note, by the way, I forgot to say on the last slide, but same on this slide, that some of these type A's are source. One's a source, right? Notice an arrow diamond is a source or a sink, and the diamonds and arrows are not, and that's going to be important because, of course, as you go around the knot, right, this is where the orientation of your smoothing along the boundary of the knot is switching, and you've got to have an even, right, you've got to balance source and sink, sources and sinks. You have to have an even number of switches. Type B is just like your traditional Gabai disc decomposition, but done on a tube. Okay, so those are your two type Bs, and those are always the same, right? Whichever one you do, you get an up, an out arrow, in arrow. And those don't give you any cusps either. In fact, the branch curves are don't even, right, the meridian isn't actually a branch curve in and of itself. And then there are your best ones, your type Cs, which give you meridional cusps. So here you have your outward meridional cusp. You can think of it kind of like a type A, except instead of a skirt, you've got like a flying saucer or something like that. I don't know what the right analogy is. And then you put the surface on in all the four ways that you can get. And so each type C gives you one of these outward pointing meridional cusps. And the nice thing about type Cs is they give you sources and sinks too, but in exactly the place where the A's don't. Okay? So you can balance A's and C's. Right? So you pay for getting the orientation along the knot you want by not getting a cusp, and you pay for the cusp with a switch in orientation sometimes, and you balance those out. Okay, so probably the easiest way to show you this is with an example. So here's a nice simple pretzel knot, the -255. This is a persistently foliar knot. Okay, the -235 is not. Okay, but as soon as you get up to 5, it's persistently foliar. It's not an L-space knot. So what do? Okay, so first we're going to stick a disc in there. Okay, and those are going to be my choices of local models at each disc crossing. Note that since this is not an alternating knot, the decomposing disc is going to miss some crossings. Okay, so now we got to see what happens to our branch curves as we go around. So there are the branch curves, and I'll sort of show you how you figure that out, right? So basically, you got to always go away. You're always going to go the back end of the arrow, right? Because you want to follow the actual cusp. So, you know, so here you are along your knot. You hit this type B crossing, you know, where the disc has crossed over your tube, and you go that way, right? And here you're coming along the knot, and again, you hit the back of the arrow. You go that way. So Bs do that. Diamonds sort of do it faster. So you get the zigzag, right? So you're coming along, you go like this, you go like that. So a diamond is like an arrow, like two arrows in opposite directions. So basically it all kind of looks like alternating arrows. Okay. And so I won't go into the details of all of them, but what does this show you? Okay, so now you've reduced the genus by one, right? You've closed up that hole. And if you follow a branch curve, you can see that you've really got a double twist here, because you can see that green curve go around and it goes back around and comes back out. Okay, so from the point of view of a surface, if you sort of simplify all that and, you know, isotope it to more minimal position, it looks like that. All right, so now, but notice now we had to introduce, maybe I didn't say it and I should point it out, we had to introduce a source, right? So there's a source, right? So now we need a sink to balance that source. And the sink is going to be here, okay? So we're going to put this one like that, right? And so now we're using A as a sink, but we're getting a cusp from the C next to the A, right? So remember, we actually, maybe I didn't mention this either, right? We do have a C in there. So we got one cusp, now we have two. Branch curves look like that, and all we need to do here, right, we've now reduced the genus to zero. So we just need to know that we have the complement of a disk with a single branch curve on it in order to have a sutured manifold, and you can, if you follow along, you see you could do. And so the complement looks just like the complement of a disk with a suture on it. And you can foliate it. And then finally, I just thought I would show you some examples of, you know, from alternating knots, because they're actually easier to follow, because since the crossings alternate, when you put in a decomposing surface, it does indeed hit every crossing. And so basically you just get twists, right? So you fill the hole and you put twists where the in arrows are, right? And so you end up with a sutured manifold that looks like the complement of a super surface, a simpler surface, and you just keep reducing the genus. And we can show that you can reduce it to zero and get a taut sutured manifold for any alternating knot. And that's what I have to say. Thank you. Questions?
Any questions for Charles?
Yeah.
How can you say again how you dealt with the fact these things were not necessarily orientable?
Yeah, let me say a little more about that. So you might think if you start off with a non-orientable surface, you've got an orientable leaf, what are you going to do about it, right? But those type C intersections, those local models, actually split the non-orientable surface. So then you split it into orientable pieces. Right, because you're not just keeping that surface and having other leaves limit onto it. You actually can cut that surface open with some of these, like with when you see a diamond, what you're actually seeing is the surface being cut open and, you know, then becoming part of another surface. Does that clarify? Yeah.
Since we have time, from someone who doesn't know pretty much anything about Heegard-Floer homology.
Yeah, well, you're also talking to someone who doesn't know almost anything about it, I'm afraid. But.
Yeah, I guess my question was, I mean, why is it interesting? Why should people study it?
Ah, well, you may have to ask the Heegard-Floer theorists, but it seems to indicate whether a manifold is complicated or not, right? So your spherical manifolds, your lens spaces, those are the two classic examples. Right, they're kind of like the simplest manifolds. And so I think the reason this question of foliation is interesting is, does being complicated mean contains a taut co-oriented foliation? And being simple means minimal Heegard-Floer homology. And by the way, so Heegard-Floer applies only to rational homology spheres, but for manifolds that aren't rational homology spheres, Gabai's work shows that they all contain taut co-oriented foliation.
So how does this homology exactly relate to the foliation?
That we don't know. So that's kind of the ultimate goal. Like, can we see...
What does it compute?
Yeah, can we understand the homology? Right, the homology is computed using Legendre and Torii and all kinds of stuff that I don't really understand in any detail. And so I guess the question is, can you see the Heegard-Floer classes in some geometric way that would show you how to build the foliation? And I don't know how to do that, but that would be an ultimate goal. If Rachel and I can learn to see that, you know, then that would be great. But I can't say I can see that now.
So why do we need it? What kind of question would it answer if you are able to compute it, say, for the homology?
If you're able to compute the homology?
Yeah, like
it's
very
computable.
So
yeah, it's very computable.
Why do you need it at all? That's my silly question here.
Oh, it's very good for.
Why don't you answer, because you know better.
So I mean, it's Heegard-Floer homology is a very powerful tool for studying how manifolds change under Dehn surgery.
So one consequence of it, for example, is if you do Dehn surgery on a knot in the three sphere and you get real projective space back, then that knot is the unknot. That's so that was a long-standing open problem that is solved by using the Heegard-Floer homology. So I mean Heegard-Floer homology is it's basically a homology theory whose exact sequences come from Dehn surgery. Like if you have three different manifolds that are Dehn surgeries on the same knot, then there's like a long exact sequence in their floor homologies. And so it's very useful for understanding Dehn surgery. And there's also I mean, there's also like a four manifold invariant, right? It's a 3+1 dimensional TQFT, basically.
Thanks, that was very helpful. I wouldn't have been able to give you that answer, so. I just trust that it's interesting.
Any other questions?
So your goal would be to produce some classes, that's what you're saying, right? These techniques here are...
You know, my goal would actually be to let the classes that are, you know, the classes that are non-minimal produce foliations, right? So if you have non-minimal Heegard-Floer homology, take one of those classes that shows you that your rank is bigger than the size of the first integer homology group, and will that show you how to build a foliation? Is there some direct relationship? I do not know. But.
Okay. Well, before we thank Charles again, let's meet in the mail room in 5 minutes for lunch. Thanks.
Thank you.